And we welcome you to the eighth inning of Mindset Matters, a mental health series from WellSpan Health. Daryl Henry with you from our WOYK studios, and we welcome WellSpan licensed psychologist, Dr. Michael Diller. Mike, hello. We have gotten to the late innings in this one. How about that?
We have. How you doing, Daryl? It's good to be back. It's wow. What do we call this? The top of the eighth, I guess, right now.
Top of the eighth. You right. Got it.
All right. And, good to be back.
Yeah, great to be back with you. And you know, I feel like I say this every week, but it's a really important episode. I think some great messages on this one. And you and I are passionate about this. So, you know, to me, they all have been. But here this week, we kind of pick up our conversation on anxiety, some of the things that people experience with that, tie it back in on how it can trigger depression or vice versa. They really do work together in strange, rather difficult ways sometimes. Right. And then thirdly, you know, we wouldn't be doing this program justice if we didn't talk about, you know, some of the worst case scenarios and some of the more difficult things that can be a result of anxiety, depression, mental health issues in general, if appropriate steps are not taken. So that's what we've got on tap this week. And I think it's another really important week that hopefully helps a lot of people.
Yeah, I'm with you, Daryl, on that 100%. And we had talked about, you know, getting through, you know, the 9 episodes, but making sure we do our best to cover kind of the topics that we think are relevant, timely, and important. And we've touched on many of those. And today, you know, we're going to finish up like that, like you said, that anxiety and depression combination, but also we're going to move into other topics that are not as easy to talk about. Not that anxiety and depression are, but we're trying to make that conversation a little bit more easy by bringing it to light. And you and I having these conversations, I think it's important. But also, we're gonna touch topics like suicide and addiction today, which is again, we won't do it justice by the time that we give it and cover it here. But if we did not mention those two things, and then also at the end provide some resources that speak to both of them, we wouldn't be doing what we set out from the first inning, the first time we got together and had a conversation, to today. So look forward to that today.
Yeah. And I mentioned it recently on one of the radio intros that we did, that, you know, once these 9 episodes are over, the conversation doesn't end. Like, this is something that we hope we are making normal for our listeners so that they feel empowered to address anything they might be dealing with, be open to talk about it. I know I shared on a recent episode how I felt after I talked about it publicly for the first time, and I have no regrets whatsoever. It was a great decision to go forward with it. So, yeah, I mean, you know, we're in the eighth inning now, but I hope it doesn't end for people, and it certainly won't for us. I know that.
No doubt. I mean, we have the broadcast, you know, on WOYK, and is that FM or 98.9 Monday nights, you know, that'll run through probably December. It may roll in a little bit to the new year of 2021, but you're right. Those YouTube, you know, segments of what we're doing here now, they're going to stay, you know, they'll be right on the, you know, the Rev's webpage, and we hope people will land on those and, you know, take a look. You know, it's not just one or two conversations, or 8 or 9 and when we're all done here, but they're really conversations to really encourage others to continue what we share here. Others are doing it as well, but this was our opportunity when, you know, we got together to say, hey, maybe we can do a little bit on our own to make a difference here and create that space and time for people to be invited to listen, so to join us, to then continue the conversation long after these 9 innings are over. So,
yeah. Well, here in the top of the eighth, let's dive back into the anxiety topic, kind of where we left it last time. And I kind of listed out some instances where I've personally experienced that. And maybe some of our listeners and viewers can identify with that and be like, oh, I've felt that too. Maybe didn't even know what it was, but you know, that makes sense now. And you know, hopefully shed some light on that. But I feel like, you know, before we do that, I feel like anxiety, when you hear that word, it's maybe not taken as seriously as depression is, just because of the word and the undertones that it brings. But I mean, it can be really crippling, and kind of, you know, function stopping for people if they're in the midst of, you know, just having a bad anxiety day, or some of the most severe instances would be a full-on attack or panic attack. That's something that a lot of people deal with.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And Darryl, I definitely want to hear some of those thoughts that you've been thinking about in terms of, you know, anxiety, that, you know, how we wanted to kind of make sure we kind of brought that to a little bit of a conclusion today. But I'm really looking forward to hearing that from you. But you're absolutely right. Anxiety can be completely paralyzing. It can kind of stop us in our tracks if we're not careful. And panic attacks are one of those things that can do it. Because sometimes people feel like they're having a physical event. Like sometimes they can't catch their breath. They feel like they might be having some type of heart event that may lead them into the emergency room, for example, to be evaluated. And it's important, if you feel like you have any kind of cardiac symptoms, that you do that. But sometimes people do come back and they're like, everything's fine physically. But they've described it as this panic attack. What in the world is that? Sometimes people don't even know what that is. Panic attack, that sounds scary. And it can be, and it can feel very scary if we don't know what that is. But those things can absolutely, you know, our anxiety alarm system, it can rise to the level, and you've used this word before, crippling. It can absolutely do that. It can interfere significantly with our daily functioning and get in the way of us being able to be our best selves and realize our full potential on a daily basis. And that may mean something as like going outside and going to a destination, going to the store, going to a restaurant, going to work, just getting dressed and leaving my house to go to the mailbox. Sometimes people struggle in those areas, and it's important to make sure that we acknowledge that. And that's what you wanted. You know, I appreciate it. You're like, hey, I want to come back to that. I want to make sure we cover that. And you had some ideas that you wanted to share with the audience members and our listeners as well. And, but it is important. You used that word crippling before in the depression side of things. It can absolutely do that. On the anxiety side of things as well.
Sure. Yeah. So, I mean, there have been various instances that come to mind, and I'll just share a few that I can think of off the top of my head. And first off, you know, some of the worst symptoms that I would tend to experience with it would certainly be, you know, like the feeling that your heart's beating out of your chest, the, you know, you get kind of clammy and sweaty, the feeling of nausea and not wanting to eat, mind racing. I mean, you know, fast, or, you know, I guess light, shallow breathing, fast heart rate. All of those things are some of the first kind of worrisome thoughts is another one. Those are all kind of the, you know, the first symptoms that I think of when it comes to anxiety. But I mean, I can think back to, like, you know, grade school, you know, being way more anxious about a presentation in front of the class than it seemed anybody else was, and, you know, kind of feeling like I was weird in that regard, feeling way more nervous about things like that, you know, playing high school baseball, overanalyzing every single little thing to the point of almost making myself sick about, you know, is my delivery the right mechanics and this and that. And so it got into sports with me in that sense. But, you know, some other ones that come to mind, I remember our Revs team in 2012. I love those guys. I'm still, you know, very close with a lot of them, but we had this thing where, that season, it seemed like every time I interviewed a guy, they would go like 0-for-5 with 3 strikeouts, and nobody wanted to do my pregame interviews anymore. And it was a big joke around the team, but, you know, to me, I didn't quite know what anxiety and depression was at the time. And it wasn't a joke to me. Like, I played along, but, like, deep down, it was the worst thing ever. You know, I felt like I was walking on eggshells and didn't want to go to work some days. And it had some difficult results for me. And I did kind of, you know, I didn't process it the way that I should have, and kind of fell into a little bit of a mental trap with that. You know, and then another instance that I can think of was I had filled in for some Hershey Bears games several years ago, and you know, with the Revs in high school and York College, jumping on the air is second nature to me. You know, it feels like home, but that was a different environment. And I felt like I had to, you know, prove myself to a different audience, and the anxiety that went with that, even, you know, for weeks leading up to it, was so bad that I would feel, you know, sick and didn't want to eat. And I actually went to some therapy sessions for that, in advance of that, to work on, you know, how can I best handle that to get me through this. And I guess it was performance anxiety, I guess. So, you know, but then I can think of other social settings, and sometimes I feel 100% comfortable in the room, and there's other times where, you know, walking into a room with a bunch of people, it's terrifying, and the thought of interacting can be overwhelming. And, you know, sometimes you feel out of place if you're feeling anxiety inside, or you feel that everything is against you and you don't belong, and you feel like people don't like you and this and that. And, you know, both anxiety and depression, you know, you can be surrounded by things that you love, people that you love, but you can still feel totally alone with the way that you're feeling. And it's a tough thing to articulate. And I think that's what leads a lot of people into some dark places, that feeling and not being able to explain it. You know, sometimes when you're anxious, you just flat out crave that isolation. Like, that's the one thing that you want, is to just kind of be alone. So it's a tricky, you know, double-edged, nasty sword. Sometimes you just feel uncomfortable in general. I know when I've had some of my major depressive bouts, I know that something's wrong, but I don't know how to articulate it. So that in itself makes me feel anxious, and there's just something deep down that feels wrong or unsettled. And then a couple of other, you know, instances where I know I've experienced it, work related, if there's a lot going on, and particularly for me, when I felt like some of the things I was struggling with were affecting my work, that daily cycle, that it's a snowball effect. I know I've used that term a lot. The fact that you're not being as productive as or your best self that you feel that you should be, that can plant further seeds for anxiety, and it can grow even more. And then kind of the last thing that I jotted down, that, you know, just something that hits home for me where I experienced that, is just kind of sensory overwhelm. And, you know, we have three little kids at home who I love dearly, but the clutter is tough to keep up with. And Katie and I talk about that a lot. If you're a person with anxiety, that clutter can make you feel like, you know, kind of a cluttered mind. And that sensory overwhelm, you know, constant noise, constant stimulation. And we live in a society now where it's tougher than ever to escape that. And I don't mean just at home. I mean, in general, with the news cycle and things of that nature. So, you know, those are, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 scenarios that I could think of off the top of my head where, you know, I've felt anxiety in a significant way, either apart from depression or as part of, you know, one of those times that I was dealing with depression. And it's crazy how they work together. But yeah. I, you know, as we brainstormed for this episode, I wanted to share as many of those examples as I could think of, you know, hopefully, I mean, I hope people aren't going through that, because it's not a fun thing to go through. But the chances of somebody feeling that exact same way in one of those exact same situations, hopefully my sharing that lets you know that, you know, you're not alone with that. It can be a pretty common thing.
No, and I think, you know, Darren, I appreciate you sharing all of those, because I think, you know, you gave very real examples that I can guarantee you that other people, because I've heard that, I've listened to other people and know other people that have had similar experiences of what you shared just there, all of those examples. And maybe not every single one can maybe connect with everybody who's listening and watching. But absolutely those things do happen. And you know, it's interesting though, too, because you hit on some things there. Like you were, the one example you were giving with the Revs, and they were saying, don't interview with Darryl because you're gonna go 0-4 tonight. It won't be good. So don't do it. And then, you know, they were joking, you were kind of going with them, but it was like, you know, in that time when you were feeling more anxious and more kind of just out of sorts, it was difficult for you to kind of just truly kind of feel like, hey, we're just joking here. They're just kidding. It was like some of that was kind of striking some chords, and it took more energy for you to really get there. Like when you first started talking about that story, I was kind of smiling kind of with you as you were reflecting back. But during that time, I'm sure you weren't smiling. I mean, it was, you know, you were on the outside, but we talked about that. What was happening on the outside sometimes doesn't match up with what's happening on the inside. And all those other examples as well. You talk about the kids, you're talking about the clutter, you're talking about noise, you're talking about stimuli. And sometimes we are such a connected and flooded society with stimuli. We don't even realize how stressed we are sometimes. We don't realize how anxious we have become sometimes in moments. And Katie, you know, is spot on with that too. She's talking about sometimes it's just really, even these small things you can do to try to reduce the noise. How can we lower the noise a little bit? Quiet the sound, quiet the stimuli a little bit, lower the sound a little bit. It can just give us a little respite to be able to kind of regroup, recharge, and try to find a different way. Sometimes, and you've talked about this too, it does require us to be, I just need a little space. I need a TO here. So let me pull back a little bit. And there's balance in that. Sometimes that's absolutely necessary. Even the most extroverted person needs a little downtime. You know, I've had people come up to me and said, I'm all peopled out today. I'm all peopled out. I need a little time. Even the most extroverted person may need that time. We do. We just need some time to just do a little self-care and recharge. And when we're struggling sometimes with being more anxious or having those anxiety feelings or depression or both, because sometimes they're together, we do still need those times. We need it within balance though, because this struggle sometimes is human nature. We want to make sure we stay connected, that we feel that we belong with others and that others have our back and that we're supported. And we don't want to also become burdens to others, perceived burdens. So sometimes we feel like, I don't want to bother you. I don't want to burden you with everything I'm going through. You described that, I think, spot. Oh, you were talking early on in one of our conversations about crying wolf and, you know, just, I've been through this again. People, you know, I don't want people to, you know, think of me in a certain way because I'm, you know, I'm here I am again. You were saying these kinds of things, but you're not alone in that. That happens more and more than any one of us sometimes ever realize. But it's important that we make sure that we, you know, we bring light to that. Like you said, these examples you gave, I can guarantee you there are going to be other people out there that have had, they can relate to some. I can relate to that, to some of those examples as well. So sometimes, though, you know, we get into these dark places and spaces. We need some time to ourselves. We have to find the balance to also stay connected to supports, you know, and I know that gets us into some of the other things that we wanted to talk about a little bit today too, because when we get into darker spaces, our natural tendency sometimes is I'm just going to withdraw. I'm going to retreat. Today, I'd rather stay underneath the sheets and the bed covers and not have to deal with the world. Sometimes we need moments of doing that. Other times, if that becomes more and more the way that we continue to stay and be and are for longer periods of time, more intense feelings, and is getting in the way with our daily functioning, we have to do something about that, and we absolutely can.